and thanks for joining our inaugural edition of Shaping Tomorrow. I'm your host, Art Morrish. Every episode, we will chat with the world's leading scientists, technologists, and researchers to come to grips with what's happening in the ever-changing world of science and technology, and to see how it affects us in our everyday lives, both today and tomorrow. In our first episode, we're going to look into the concept of security in the modern, digital, always-on world. Why is individual and collective security so important today, and how it ties into the threat to our security that has been enhanced by the faster, easier-to-manipulate technologies that are coming onto the scene? To answer these questions and more, I'm joined by Dr. Shreekant, better known as Dr. Ticky. He is the chief researcher of the Secure Systems Center, Secure Systems Research Center, SSRC, at the Technology Innovation Institute here in Abu Dhabi. Dr. Ticky, it's a real pleasure to have you on our first show. Welcome. Can you tell us a little bit about what it means to be the chief researcher at SSRC, Secure Systems Research Center? How technology that you're working on there affects everybody's everyday lives, and where it really fits under the TII umbrella?
Right. Thanks for having me here, Art. It's a good opportunity to talk about some of the really exciting things we're doing here. One of the key things that we're doing is really trying to figure out, in a modern world, as you look at the modern world of edge devices and the back-end systems, how are these things going to be managed securely and autonomously? And so our goal is to define end-to-end security and resilience for these class of autonomous and cyber-physical systems. The way we're doing it, you know, part of the TII, it's as you look at the modern cities such as Dubai, Abu Dhabi, we have large cities that are managed by, you know, by edge devices. And these are physical things that are connected to digital environment. And as you look at those systems are not going to be humanly managed. They're managed. They're going to be managed by autonomous systems that basically figure out how to keep the, you know, the traffic lights running, how to keep the airports running, how to keep the water supplies running, how to keep planes in the air running. And so these vulnerabilities increase enormously as you connect physical to digital environment. We think the phones were, you know, very, significant amount of devices of 1 billion phones or 2 billion phones connected to the backend. We are talking about billions and billions of individual devices connected to digital backend, which is making decisions of how the life in the modern cities work, how the planes keep in the air, how the trains run. And if we are not careful, the vulnerabilities, the security vulnerabilities from a malicious to bringing the country down to its knees can be done very simply by exploiting these vulnerabilities in these digital systems. So what we are designing is how to design these systems ground up from the hardware all the way to all the software stacks, or communication stacks, being secure from ground up. And then as the as somebody brings in malware or to exfiltrate data or to disturb the system integrity of that system, the system is resilient enough to be able to reconfigure itself and continue operating.
So, you know, everybody's really worried about all these digital systems that we have that are connected to the cloud, whether it's your refrigerator, your washing machine, you know, the IoT device that sits on your countertop and orders your groceries for you. How does what you're doing affect that?
So what we are trying to do is really build an environment for such a digital system that you're describing. We're using a set of, you know, drones that are autonomously managed by the backend cloud system. And it's to simulate the digital city, the smart city environment, the smart car environment. What we have is a set of drones that are managed by the autonomous environment. with a cloud backend. And we try to connect these things up securely. We construct them securely. So the if you take a drone system, we have pulled it apart, and from hardware level up, we have put security features in it, because today the vulnerabilities are enormous in this class of systems, such as you can take the drone out from the, while it's flying, attack its wireless network capability and, bring it down and capture it and extract the data. It's not encrypted in majority of the cases. Or you could hijack its video feed, maybe going real time into some police environment or such, and a terrorist can capture that and, manipulate that video stream to do incredible amount of harm to a state or a country, Mm-hmm. And so what we're trying to do is design these systems ground up with hardware, software, hardening, and communication hardening, and have the things autonomously managed. Now, as we go to the autonomous management part of it, we're not talking about a single drone just flying autonomously and avoiding obstacles and such. We're talking about a large system. Let's say we have 100 drones, and they work in a swarm as a drone, doing surveillance for the country. Whether we're looking at, seeing how the ports are managed, or the construction site is managed, or the agriculture environment is managed. These drones are autonomously controlled by a backend. It's not a human controlling it. It's really a computer system controlling it. So the vulnerabilities now go even step beyond, because you have a computer system controlling autonomous devices and basically driving that. So the amount of worry you have is, how do we protect this whole environment? And if we say, well, let's not go over there because it's too hard, then our cities are still going to remain the way they are. They are not going to progress. And the people who, in other countries who get there are going to take advantage of the economic growth that these new capabilities are going to bring. Because the whole purpose of this work is, it will bring new growth as we have to manage smart cities, smart vehicles, smart planes, smart drones. We need to have that economic growth.
So let me pull on that string just a little bit more, because as I talked about a little bit in my introduction, everybody's going to the Internet of Things, right? IoT. And like I said, everything from your dishwasher to, Alexa or Google Assistant or right. somebody like that, ordering groceries, all that sort of stuff. That all goes up to the cloud too. So do we have the same level of vulnerabilities with those kinds of systems that you would with drones? I would think so.
Absolutely, we have the same vulnerabilities. The decision for us to tackle the drones was, we wanted to manage a set of things without having a lot of infrastructure in between, so that we could do research. We see drones as Internet of Things. They are just, and we have layers of them.
Just
we have
another thing on the internet.
Right, they are just another edge devices, and our drones are all already in a kind of a mesh configuration. So they have, there's a mother drone with its slave drones, and there's several mother drones that are connected to the internet, to the cloud-based system through, Wi-Fi or wireless LAN, or 5G, all of those things. So this is very similar to the way an IoT device is connected to the backend cloud, whether it's an AWS cloud or Google cloud with a Google Assistant and, iPod, Apple Pods and all of those things. They're just identical from that perspective. The level of security that people worry about as you go to a city level or a state level services is significantly higher, Yes, those devices are just as vulnerable, because in the early days, you could hack into somebody's device. And actually, there was an article in Wall Street Journal where the journalist was taken, and she had a baby monitor in her home.
I heard about that.
Yeah. You remember that, yep. Right? And she was horrified because a guy who was the person who came and showed how vulnerable it was, showed him on his PC her baby sleeping in her home, you know. And she was completely petrified, you know, of, you know, and this is, we're talking about one human being, you know, and being monitored. But again, this is important. Yes. We are talking about millions of lives controlled in smart cities through, you know, enabled, where people are not going to think about this kind of stuff. You know, the new services that are coming out, if you look at it, are such as, I think if you were in Dubai or some of the larger cities here, and certainly back home in USA, you get in San Francisco, if you're driving into a car park, you have an app that actually shows you where you can park your car inside a garage, you know. And the same thing goes in Dubai and all of those things. So those are all internet cameras that are connected to a back end. And, you know, they're not humans who are trying to put, oh, floor number 4, parking slot number 10 is open. It's really the computer systems that are defining. Now, in those cases, attacking those things are small compared to, so let's say, attacking traffic light systems in Abu Dhabi, you know. I mean, can you imagine the chaos it would cause if somebody were to attack the traffic lights in Abu Dhabi?
Yeah.
Right? Or the new airport, you know, system, and bringing the airport down. They brought the whole country down back in 2011 inside, you know, in Europe, where, you know, it was
Georgia,
Estonia, and Georgia as well, where, you know, Russians brought down, you know, the some of the hackers in Russia brought down the country to its knees, basically by shutting down electricity, computer systems, you know, traffic lights, name it, everything that was computerized was brought down. Now, we're talking about 2011. We are 10 years into, into this era. And the era is enormously vulnerable than it was in 2011.
So now that you scared the living daylights out of all of us, we're going to take all of our IoT things and put them in the dumpster. And you've talked about a lot of very technical things. Can you maybe bring it down a level and tell us what a day in the life of somebody in SSRC is? What they do to actually try and protect us?
Sure. So let's talk about, you know, the engineers who are building the secure drones. Mm-hmm. And so one of the key things we're doing there is working with the ecosystem. So when we talk about ecosystem and drones, what is the ecosystem for drone? Where there's things like autopilot that runs on the drone itself. There's the robot operating system that runs on the mission computer that actually does all of these things. So when you take an engineer whose role, for example, is to look at PX4, which is the autopilot, open source autopilot, and look at what are the security vulnerabilities in this code? You know, does it do encryption? Does it do, you know, how is it communicate outside? Does it store the keys properly? Is the processor on that machine that is used for the autopilot, does it have memory protection and all of those kind of things? So these are the kind of things from hardware and software perspective the engineers basically do. And what they do is they create then, you know, new changes to the PX4 software. And since we are part of the ecosystem, we load that software we upstream it back into the open source so that the ecosystem becomes smarter. The ecosystem now has a secure key management, has memory protection, and all of those things. So that's really how the life of an engineer in this case works. You know?
So if I was a young college student and I thought, man, I want to go work for Dr. Ticky, what should I do? You know, what kind of classes should I take? Where should I think about my career going? What are the kinds of things I should think about?
Well, I think, you know, first, I would like to see a lot of the bright and bushy-tailed people.
Absolutely.
You know, right?
They're the future.
And really, first of all, you know, you need to have the enthusiasm and curiosity. Those are kind of the two vital things. And then, you know, and to to look at any new problems that you're excited about. You know, the security and resilience for us is today, you know, you have to, you know, you're going to need the basic skills of software, you know, mm-hmm. hardware. And in addition, you need to understand what does, you know, key management, what does a public key crypto system mean? You know, how do you design secure protocols? You know, and then there's a lot of examples in, you know, that are used. For example, TLS is open source, you know, protection, secure protocol, communication protocol. You know, how does things work, you know, in terms of encrypting, you know, doing symmetric encryption, you know, what is the difference between asymmetric and symmetric encryption? These are kind of nuts and bolts of what you need to know. And then you have to come up with the curiosities of saying, okay, I have to make this, you know, whether you're working on a drone or a phone, how does the drone work? How does the phone work? You know, mm-hmm. and so these are kind of things that you kind of, you take your basic building blocks and then you learn about things where you're going to apply them.
Yeah. That sounds like a real noble endeavor. I mean, you know, when I was a kid, I wanted to be an astronaut. You know, other kids want to go into the military, but protecting things like this, that sounds like a really cool job description.
It is. It's amazing how, you know, I started looking at security back in, you know, 97, 98 timeframe for Intel Corporation. And, you know, the idea was, and this was just the beginning of the times of where, yeah, there was a firewall created. There was something called Blue Ice or something that ran on the PCs at the time. And I actually started to look at how do you make the processor, you know, do something securely without somebody trying to grab the keys while, because it's an open processor, mm-hmm. right? So we were all thinking about how do you make these mechanisms where the processor actually, and if you're familiar with, you know, Star Trek, the Klingon ships used to clock. And what that means was they had this mechanism where it would disappear in front of you. So we were trying to figure out, okay, how can we make the, you know, clocking inside the processors, you know? Mm-hmm. So we basically invented, you know, the mechanism where we would clock the processor insides so that from an operating system and all of those perspectives, nobody would know what's happening, you know, while this code is executed, right?
So
these were the beginnings of those days. And so we need to start thinking along those lines and say, okay, how do we do new things? And so, you know, we're all excited about clocking technology and stuff. So for me, you know, it's one of the, you know, very curious and very intriguing technology. And every day we come in, we think about, aha, there's always an aha moment. You know, how are we covering that? You know, what happens if the system, you know, let's say an alien drone walks into a swarm, and how do you recognize it's an alien drone? Because it could be just following you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you look at a human beings, you know, let's say there were 10 security guards walking outside and 11 one came in, and suddenly people will question, even though he's wearing the same clothes and stuff, where did you come from? Mm-hmm. You know, so we need to figure out how we're going to authenticate that this thing is an alien and, you know, cut him out from anything it's trying to get at from us, mm-hmm. you know. So these are really exciting and intriguing problems, and then you're inventing technology to prevent those things from happening. So for me, it's not just security, it's actually solving puzzles, you know, and you're figuring out on the day, okay, because you're trying to be ahead of the guy who's going to try and break into the things, mm-hmm. always,
yep.
right? So that's the exciting part, is you want to be two steps ahead of anybody who is coming in to try and, you know, get at something that you're trying to protect.
Yeah, I can tell you're really passionate about
it. Yeah, absolutely.
This is great. Yeah. So I want to go maybe back a little bit. You mentioned open source several times, and I believe your organization belongs to an open source foundation.
Yes.
Can you tell our listeners a little bit about what open source means? Because I would think, just being a chemist, that you would want to keep all of the things that you're doing absolutely proprietary and not have it open source. So why is this important?
Sure. So the first the first and most popular open source today is Linux. Mm-hmm. Linux operating system was created by Linus Torvald from Finland, and he decided to make an operating system open, and the fundamentals from him was that if I open it up, there are many thousands of eyes that can look at what's being done, and a better solution could be built because, you know, those thousands of eyes will go and fix things and make things better than if it's done in a proprietary environment, because you, no matter whether you are a Microsoft or a Google, the amount of people you have is finite. Mm-hmm. When you are in open source, it's not finite. You have got the whole, and the web, the internet basically opened up the possibility of those people to collect, you know, that open source, modify it, put it back so people can look at it. And Linus put in a very nice environment where there were maintainers of pieces of the code. And these maintainers would basically check people's code, you know, mm-hmm. and look at the comments that other people have done. And so it's a nice system of managing the open source code to make sure we get the best out of that open source. And if you look at today, Linux operating system is the key operating system in using all data centers everywhere, right? So that's the kind of the power of open source. For us, the open source brings in yet another level of transparency that you need when you're building a secure systems. So if you look at how a lot of the crypto algorithms, asymmetric, symmetric algorithms are developed.
Can you define what those two mean?
Very good. The asymmetric is used for authentication. So let's say you and I are trying to send mail to each other, but I don't know who Arthur is, mm-hmm. and you don't know who Ticky is. So I give you my public key, and you give me your public key, and then you encrypt things with your private key. And when I decrypt it with your public key, I know it was you who sent that mail. And so this is the standard protocol, RSA, developed by folks from MIT and some of the other universities. They allowed you to first establish public key based authentication. Symmetric key is public keys are usually very big to authenticate and stuff. The symmetric stuff is, let's say now you've authenticated me, that's it's Ticky, and you want to send me some, a file that was, very valuable thing that we were working on, and you want to encrypt it so that it doesn't get snooped by somebody in between. So you will send me, share with me, the key, or somehow we exchange the key through our public key mechanism when we did the authentication, and you use the symmetric cipher to encrypt the content of whatever you wanted to send me. You send it to me. I use the key that you sent me to basically decrypt the stuff. And so those keys are usually smaller than the other keys.
So it's more efficient.
Yeah, much more efficient and stuff.
Okay, so Ticky, how does symmetric and asymmetric then apply to open source? Why is that such an important topic?
What I was trying to get to was one of the things in security is transparency. And one of the things we are trying to, and the example I was giving to you was about the asymmetric and symmetric key algorithms. They are developed by, usually sponsored by U.S. government institute, whether it's National Science Foundation or DARPA, and the algorithms are developed in public.
Okay.
So there are candidates for the algorithms proposed by all sorts of people. And then people go, try to break it and see what's the best algorithm. And then there's a vote at the end. And so those algorithms are selected, but they are completely developed in transparency. So the value you get with the that method is that you basically now got billions of eyes looking at those algorithms, and it's done in open, so it's not controlled by any governments, you know, because that's another fear people have. The value that the individual, you, me, the government, or institutions protect using those algorithms is in the keys. Our keys are the value that protects, you know, it's not the the mechanism. It's okay. The keys that protect
the stuff. It's not the lock, it's the key.
Yes, it's the key that's the most valuable thing, right? Okay. So taking that and saying, okay, we're developing security. What, you know, let's say we're building this open source drone-based system. We want the drone software, hardware, any kind of security protocols that it uses to be in that same level of transparency, right? And we want people to then have millions of eyes looking at that code, right? And those millions of eyes will make sure that the code is robust. Now, when we use that drone software, the PX4 autopilot, and it's sending something to the cloud, we will have our keys to protect the end-to-end mechanism. So we want to make sure that we give this the ecosystem that creates these drones, software, hardware, you know, to be robust, you know, as such. And that's the power of open source for us, because we want to give and enrich that open source system to make it even better. Okay. Right.
So if some of our listeners wanted to be some of those millions of eyes, what would they do?
They just need to be part of the open source organization, or, and you can become a member without any cost to you. You will get full, you look at this GitHub repository where the source code is, you can look at it, you can play with it, you can change it, you can try to send it to the maintainers of the, to get that, you know, if you found a bug, most than likely it will be fixed. And that fix will be adopted by the source code. Now, take the other way around, which is saying, let's not use open source because I want to protect my drone. Well, I develop my drone software in secret, and I, you know, because I want to protect it. I don't want anybody to know what's in there. Now you have vulnerabilities in that software potentially, because you didn't have millions of eyes looking at it.
Right.
And they didn't make, you know, there were things that could have made it better, but you didn't have people to do efficiency. You had 10 engineers working on it, right? And so you now have vulnerabilities in your drone. And anytime a new feature comes out in the open source or new capability comes out, you have to adopt that and put that into your drone, because your drone didn't have that feature, you know, or your drone didn't have that security capability. So it becomes very, and then you're now selling this to a government or an institution, and you say, well, it's my secret sauce that's in here. And they're going to say, wait a minute, how do I know that there's no backhole in there, right? And so backdoor into this system. So this is why we think the open source is so powerful, you know, and we can still build our own IP in the cloud in how we manage our system and all of those things. And anybody else who uses that mechanism can do that. I think, you know, even the large institutes today, you know, if you look at the helicopter that was first, the drone helicopter flown on Mars, it was built on open source.
Right.
You can download that today.
Yep.
And you can use, you can look at it and the whole code. It wasn't, you know, and this is the power of open source. You've got billions of eyes looking at it, and they, you know, and nobody has what you call crown jewels.
Right.
The crown jewels is your keys, how you manage, and all of those things, not the mechanism themselves.
So there you go, folks. If you want to help Ticky make his systems more secure, he's told you how to be some of his millions of eyes. So Dr. Ticky, you know, we've talked about a lot of things. And as I said, I'm a chemist, so I know very little about some of what you were talking about. You made it really, really clear. So maybe you can explain RISC-V to me. I hear about that as being kind of the next big thing, but I really don't understand what it's about.
Thank you, Art. And RISC-V is a processor design, an open source processor design again. And it's an open source, just like Linux is, or PX4 in the autopilot is. This is a hardware open source, which is different than the software open source that we've talked about. And the beautiful thing about this architecture is that it, just like Linux can be modified, this can also be modified. There's a community that manages the architecture, that defines the architecture. And just to give you some perspective, you know, I have worked on, you know, one of the most popular architecture on the planet, which is the Intel architecture, you know, being x86 based architecture. And I, you know, used the ARM architecture, you know, as well, in one of my, couple of my jobs as well. So I'm very familiar with the processor architecture. I worked on the design of many processor designs at Intel, you know, going from things that went into the server to the things that went into a phone and a tablet, you know, all the way from, you know, whole spectrum of design. What RISC-V gives us is an open source, which Intel can't open source its own processors and such. And why does it matter for us? You know, you say, Intel's done a great chip design, and I love the Intel designs, I love the ARM designs. They've both done a great job in putting their designs out. However, once these institutes or these companies actually build their stuff, they have to lock it down in terms of how they manage the upgrades or bug fixes and all of those things. And from a security perspective, there enters what I called earlier transparency. You don't have transparency as a user or as a solution provider of what Intel does or what Qualcomm does internally into their architecture. And if you wanted to protect some keys or secrets, you know, you have to be in a layer above where Intel and the Qualcomms would do things, right? What open source allows us to do is, first of all, the architecture is open, so it's transparent. You know how the holes are or not the hole, where the holes, you know, don't, because it's, again, got billions of eyes looking at the stuff. Mm-hmm. So it's exposed in that perspective. But what it does for us in UAE is give us a design, an architecture that we can modify, right?
Yeah.
And we put things we modify back into open source because we're part of the same open source community. And what it allows us to do is when we built the firmware or something internally, we can control it from almost the silicon level up, right? Which we don't have that opportunity inside an Intel chip or a Qualcomm chip, right? And whenever, you know, and look, many countries have licensed ARM chips, you know, and they, you know, they are available as, you know, in terms of, they're not open source, but they're available to, as an IP, you pay money to the, you know, ARM and you can get it. And as ARM was an independent company, that was acceptable to many people saying, ah, these guys are independent. But now they're owned by NVIDIA. Mm-hmm. So it's they've become another Intel,
right?
You know, that owns that chipset or the processor architecture. And this allows the community to build an architecture. So we're talking about, you know, putting in new instructions in there from our side, working with the community that allows you basically, you know, the hypervisor support, you know, which Intel and, you know, ARM have built in theirs, but this is open source. Mm-hmm. So we can look at it, what we're building. If many eyes can go and say, this works, that doesn't work, we want to make it this way or that way. And it gets basically built in, right?
Yeah.
And we can all use it. And let's say we wanted to put in another feature in there to support, you know, a real-time memory system. We can make the changes and we give it back to the open source and say, hey, an open source, this is to support, you know, real-time performance, which the drones need, real-time management,
right.
You know. And so this allows us flexibility and it allows the ecosystems, you know, to basically you know, later on, let's say somebody else wants to build a drone using that architecture, they can take the architecture, you know, and one of the silicon vendors can, you know, maybe they don't want to build the silicon themselves, but a silicon vendor can build silicon that sells.
And you could license them the firmware and if you they can, wanted it.
Yes, that's right.
Got it.
Right. Okay. And our firmware will be our firmware, you know, and that's our IP. And that's what we control, right? But it's open for any other institute or any other company to put their own firmware in it, and it doesn't belong to Intel or you know NVIDIA or ARM. You know, we are able to modify those things ourselves, right? So that's the power of RISC architecture, and you know we are looking at the first generation RISC architecture to have. From a security perspective, to have some hypervisor, you know, support, so that allows us a better security support for, you know, compartment, you know, supporting things like KVM or SEL4 in hardware. Also allows us to put in, you know, as I said to you earlier, some support for supporting real-time operating systems better. So we are putting that in. Again, we're going to give it away back to the open source. And then eventually we want to put in triple redundancy so that if one of the flight controller goes down, you know, we want to be another processor to pick it up and continue going. So let's say if something attacked through malware and took one processor out, we want to be able to continue. So this comes back to security and resilience in end-to-end, you know, right? Systems, right? You start from the drone all the way to the cloud. You want to protect, provide security and resilience. That's what we do. Yeah.
Well, you know, this has been great, Dr. Ticky. I you know, I've learned a lot. I hope our listeners have learned a lot as well. So I want to give you the opportunity, if there was one thing that you wanted to tell our listeners that I haven't asked you the question on, what would it be?
So you're coming to my heart in terms of where I would like to see. The technology will be used in many, many different environments. It will be used in, you know, logistics, as we have talked about, you know, transporting goods, between vendors and, you know, whoever wants, you know, the customers want to use it, surveillance, et cetera, protecting the country. And in, you know, it will proliferate into the smart city systems as well. But what allows, what you know, I'm really excited, and this is something I want to work, for example, with the Dubai Desert Conservation Reserve, which is a reserve of flora and the animal life in the desert environment here between Dubai and Abu Dhabi, is can I use my systems to try it out in that environment? Today, each of those... they use drones, but the drones are used in a very small way in the sense that the person will fly over to the site where they want to record something, and they will fly the drone for half an hour or so. They take the video that's in the drone, take it back to their office, and then analyze the stuff. Now, think about this reserve is watched 24/7, and the guys don't have to run out there and collect the data. The data is coming in through the drone system, through this autonomous system that's been managed internally through the cloud-based system. And they are able to monitor, you know, flora. They can see the migration. They can then monitor security of the compound, because there were some people who were actually trespassing it to avoid the COVID regulation between Dubai and Abu Dhabi. So, you know, it's now managed completely, and it's protecting the vulnerables, you know, which
well,
is...
that's kind of been your theme all the way through.
Yeah, it's protecting the vulnerables, which are the animals and the flora and the birds, you know, in this environment. And we want those things to be available for generations, you know, and see them. Because this is, you know, what human life is about. We are not alone on this planet. We have these beings that we want to protect them and want to see our children's children and for generations to decades to come to see this thing. And so taking that to the next level you know, I was born in Kenya, and I'm still passionate about, and I've lived most of my life in the United States. I'm still passionate about the wildlife in Kenya. Whenever I go there, it just kind of, you know, my heart just sinks in there. And seeing the beautiful animals, you know, that are, you know, there, the elephants, the leopards, the cheetahs, the, you know, water buffaloes, etc., and rhinos. However, they are the most vulnerable beings today on the planet. The poaching is killing this, you know. People are killing elephants for their tusks. And they're killing rhino, which is already, these are endangered species, for a horn, you know, as an aphrodisiac and stuff like that. And so what I want to do is basically provide a 24/7 system that will help the rangers manage and protect this animal environment. And it also helps not just the, in Kenya, you know, the animals also encroach into farmlands and such. So by having such a system and having, you know, protecting the farmers from, you know, their livestock being taken, and so it protects the, you know, the farmer, and it protects the animals as well. And it protects, you know, and we want to see these things, these animals there for decades. They're beautiful animals.
Well, thank you, Dr. Ticky. This has been an amazing conversation, and I think everybody can really get on board with trying to protect the vulnerables. This is, you know, that's a very noble life's work. So
thank you, and thanks for the opportunity.
Well, thank you, Dr. Ticky. That was really amazing stuff, as I said before. I really want to thank you for joining us. And I really want to thank you all for joining us as well for our initial edition of Shaping Tomorrow. If you've got any questions for anyone at the TII team that you want to have answers to, send them to our social media channel. We will read them, we will answer them, and we will get back to you. But for now, I want to thank you for joining us, and I will see you next time. This is Art Morrish, and we'll see you next time on Shaping Tomorrow.